of the qiyas, as I said.
Now, as I told you before, nobody can say that at the time of the Sahaba, Tabi'in, Atba' Tabi'in, someone said this in the religion is haram because of this, because of qiyas. You will not find it nowhere. Even people who say qiyas admit this. The first person ever who made qiyas as general rule is Shafi'i. Not even Abu Hanifa. Even Abu Hanifa was doing a lot of qiyas. As we said last time, qiyas, according to the majority, is acceptable. It's nature, by nature, and is acceptable by religion. That is according to the majority. According to those who don't say qiyas, they say it is a human nature to do qiyas, but it's haram, forbidden by religion. And they gave dalil, and we mentioned some of the dalil. According to the Mu'tazila, they say it's not acceptable neither by nature, neither by what is not acceptable because we see human being, you talk to someone, straight away he will do qiyas. Now, the people who came after Shafi'i, one of the best people who have spoken against qiyas and gave them the strongest evidence ever, and made actually the people of qiyas change their tactics. It means he came and whatever they said about qiyas, he clearly explained that this is not right, and they couldn't even give an answer. So they went and they invented a new. So they came with a new thing. They admit that what their people before said is wrong. So they came with the new stuff to prove that qiyas, which is even weaker and doesn't make sense. That's just because there is no people who have written after Ibn Hazm doesn't mean that is people just think, okay, Ibn al-Qayyim came and he refuted what Ibn Hazm has said. And Ibn Nawawi refuted what Ibn Hazm has said. And Ibn Kathir refuted what Ibn Hazm said. First, the people who have said that there is qiyas in religion were always asked, what is your proof that qiyas in religion, that you can do qiyas in religion? They never brought a dalil. They always give you an example. If you don't do qiyas, okay, what are you going to do with this? If you don't do qiyas, they always say, usul fiqh, the fundamental rule of understanding, the usul fiqh, are supposed to be made so the particular rules, the particular cases be taken from the general rule. The general rule, you make it first, the pillar, and then from it you take the cases. Not the cases and then from them you make the, okay, because I don't, because this is like this, this is like this, the general rule, no. First, it's the general rule. We have to obey Allah and the Rasul. And then every time Allah says, do this, I don't say, oh, you have to obey Allah and the Rasul. What is the reason? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, pray, and we pray. No. We pray because we have to obey the... First, we establish the rule. And then from it, we can decide each case. You don't make the look at the cases and from the cases make the rule. But when it comes to qiyas, because they never had dalil, the dalil, now I go to, because Ibn al-Qayyim, according to the Salafis, he say he refuted and he explained, his dalil for qiyas is said that Allah, Quran, I looked at Quran, and Quran is all about qiyas.
Who said this?
Ibn al-Qayyim. He said, Quran is all about doing qiyas. How? He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives examples. About the creation of the human.
Parables.
About how he created human. And he said, the way he created him, he will bring him back. He gave examples. How he make the earth survive after its death. And he say this way he will create human being again after his death. He say all these show you qiyas. He say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he mentioned the stories, he say عبرة. There is like the word عبرة. We mentioned it like that. That is, it is like you look at it and think about it, like the story of the brother of Yusuf. He mentioned it and he's at the end he said, لقد كان لكم في قصصهم عبرة. In their stories there is عبرة for you to look and think. And then about the Khaybar people, about the Jewish people, Bani Nadir, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliate them because of their kufr, not following the Prophet. And he says, فَاعْتَبِرُوا يَا أُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. Look, if you do what they have done, same thing will happen to you. He said, this is qiyas. This is his first dalil. This is some of his dalil. He say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given example about the kafirs, that they are like cattle. He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said about the one who has given knowledge but he never used it. He is like a dog. So this is, he says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, يَا أَيُّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْتُلُوا الصَّيْدَ وَأَنْتُمْ حُرُمٌ. Don't kill the animals, savage animals, while in state of ihram. وَمَنْ قَتَلَهُ مِنْكُمْ مُتَعَمِّدًا, and whoever kills it intentionally, فَجَزَاءٌ مِثْلَ مَا قَتَلَ مِنَ النَّعَمِ. You should replace it with something similar from the animals, to sacrifice it in Kaaba. That is, has to be judged by two people, two amongst you. He said, this is qiyas. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing qiyas here. Astaghfirullah, that Allah is doing qiyas. He said that the Prophet, a man came to the Prophet and asked him, my wife, the man is white, his wife is white, given birth to a black boy. Rasulullah said, do you have camels? Yes. What's their colors? Grey. Anything, any, these camels, do they produce like different camel? Yes. Where do they get it from? Maybe one of the camel's ancestor was having this color. He said, maybe one of your ancestors was black. So he said, Rasulullah here did qiyas. This is almost here like his strongest dalil. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know from qiyas, so the qiyas is this. Something where there is no dalil, which we don't believe that exists, because everything there is dalil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تِبِيَانَ لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. The book, he sent it to explain everything. So, this is the qiyas. Qiyas is something that has no dalil. You look at something that is similar, and you give it the same hukm. You give it the same. If this is haram, and this is looks like it, this should be haram. If this is halal, if this is an obligation, and this is something similar, it has to be an obligation. We make it an obligation. And we call the first one where there is hukm, we call it the root. And the one that we give it hukm according to the root, we call it the branch. This is what the branch. So, we start with the human and the grass. Who is the root and who is the branch? Is the grass the root? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained how he... So, the grass is the root and the human here is the branch. So, because if they are similar, we have to give the same hukm. So, we have to expect either human to be born in the spring and to die in the winter, because this is how the grass and it should be eaten by the animals, because not being asked about his deeds, because the grass is never asked. The grass will not go to Jannah, will not go to Hellfire.
But how come we're comparing the grass and the...
But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared the surviving the
sentence. He's going back to the dalil that he gave.
He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said he will make you survive life again.
Oh yeah, like the earth.
Like, yeah.
Okay,
so he said here, it's qiyas.
No, sir.
So if it's qiyas, we have to give it the same hukm.
No.
Because it's qiyas is all about, it's not about comparing something to something.
Yeah.
You can compare anything to anything.
No.
You can compare a donkey to any human.
No.
Because he is alive, he has a life.
No.
He has a heart, he has a heart. He walk, he walk. He can, he drink, he drink.
You know when they use qiyas,
yeah.
Do they try to use it in a way that they say it's limited to this one point and other than there, we can't use it? So for example, you said that if they're going to say the grass and what Allah says about it, then the rays in the, die in the winter, rays in the spring, live in the summer, the, would they then say, no, we're trying to say that a point, take an isolated point, not everything in general.
Of course they will go and say that when you put them in, when you give them this, they will go to treat.
Yeah.
But this is not the way they thought about it first time. Then he's saying that Allah is doing qiyas in Quran. He's explaining to you to from this to do qiyas. Actually, he's explaining to me not to do qiyas. Because he tell me this is like this, but this is has hukm and this is has hukm. So you shouldn't do qiyas. Or the that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created you. And he will create you the way he created you the first time. So the way he created you in the first time. So it's the same hukum. So am I expecting that now after I die, my father and my mother are going to get married again and they will be born again the same way. And they will have to pray and fast and die and then again coming back to the life and die and go back, die
incarnation.
This is if you put it that way, you are going to be born the way. All Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here is to the some people who say it's not possible to someone to born to be created again. Why? If he can bring you from nothing, he can bring you again. It has nothing to do with okay, because this is like this. It has the same hukm. It has to be, we give it the same hukm. Nothing in this ayah. Nothing. And this is what our dispute is about. And even if Allah was doing something like this, saying, I made give this hukm to this because it's similar to this, that is what he can do. Because every time he gave example to himself, and after he finished giving the example, he said, don't give examples. Anyone who wants to make examples, you can give example to whatever you want. As long as you don't make halal and haram. This is haram, this is halal. Because this is haram, because this is haram. And this is halal, because this is halal. No, it's fine. Of course, we will need some Quran just for...
Really, if it was part of Sharia, really thinking about it, Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba, they would have mentioned it.
Yeah. So they say that they will give you examples.
But they're saying he's trying to indicate.
I will give you the examples that they give where the Sahaba has given done qiyas.
Okay.
And they will not argue that the fact that some Sahaba has done qiyas, yes.
Yeah.
That is, I say, this is a human nature. But is there any dalil that you should do it? No.
If we use qiyas,
yeah.
Then the same way that
Nasara,
they use qiyas to say Isa alayhi salam is the son of Allah, because they say he said this and he said that, and this means he is the son of God and he is God.
We'll go to that inshallah. The thing is, the dalil about qiyas, I told you, this is his dalil. He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared a human who has been given knowledge and he didn't use it to a dog. This is qiyas. Okay, if it's qiyas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Rasulullah said, if a dog not drink, licks from a bowl,
vessel.
Yeah, what you do, you have to wash it 7 times. So if we find one of these shuyukh, and he licks from a bowl, we have to wash it 7 times. But this is qiyas. This is what Shafi'i said. Shafi'i said because a pig is like a dog, and Rasulullah said you have to wash it 7 times. This is qiyas. He did qiyas here. He said if a pig licks from a bowl, we have to wash it 7 times. Shafi'i only. The other don't accept this.
So why did you come to the point when you said, where was the idea that a dog and a...
Now he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has compared the one who doesn't...
Act upon his knowledge.
Yes, as a dog.
Okay.
Yeah? And this qiyas is this. If something is similar to something, you give it...
The same hukum. So if you find a Shafi'i not acting upon his knowledge, and if he licks somewhere, you give him the same hukum as the dog.
Yeah, because Shafi'i here said this qiyas. Because a dog is like khinzir. This is najis and this is najis. It's dirt. So what happens here? He said when a pig licks from a bowl, even though there is no hadith about that, you have to wash it 7 times. This is the qiyas. So, first when you hear it, you get, he's right. But when you get the example and the answer to it, you will find, oh, it's stupid. This is how the Quran tell us not to do qiyas. Nobody can know the similar things better than Allah. The Kafirs told to the prophets. In hada illa basharun mithlukum. The Kafirs, when the prophet come to them, they say, this is just a human like you. He eats what you eat, and you drink what you drink. The prophets never said you are wrong. They said, in nahnu illa basharun mithlukum. Yes, we are human like you. ولكن الله يمن على من يشاء. Allah bestows His favors to whom He wants. We are human like you, but we are prophet. You are not. And just because we are human like you doesn't mean that you are prophets like us. This is Quran against qiyas. The story that he said about Yusuf. Look at the ibra from them. This is qiyas. Everybody who had fight with his brothers and was sold by brothers, he will become king of Egypt? Okay, take ibra from what happened to Bani Nadir when Rasul, because of their kufr, for four or five years of kufr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them destroy their houses and humiliated them, and he gave the Muslims what they owned. Everybody who does this, every kafir who does the kufr, this will happen to him? The people of Nuh, for 1,000 years they were doing kufr. The people of Nuh. The people of Lot did something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his angel and moved the village and turned it upside down. The number of people who do that act in this country are more than the whole tribe of Lot. Women and men. And nothing happened similar to them like in this country for many years. And some people have been doing kufr all their life, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the last minute, He bestow His mercy on them and they become Muslim, like people of Mecca. And other people have been turned into pigs, into monkeys. Where is the qiyas here?
You know when they say ibra, as we just said in the Quran, ibra.
Yeah.
He's saying, look and ponder over the story. So then, how did they derive from this qiyas?
Is
from
how I tell you how did they derive it? Because they couldn't find any dalil. So they are. You see, when you are in the sea.
Yeah.
Huh? When you are in the sea, and there is nothing where you go. Huh? And you see a matches stick. What do you do?
You grab the
matches. You grab it. You understand? Because the only option you have, you will touch it, maybe it will save me.
One question is what you said about, you know when you say, have you read on it, that when it says that the comb of Lut, that the angel made the earth turn upside down, do you mean literally turn upside down like that? Because I remember some kafir trying to mock it.
فَجَعَلْنَا عَالِيَهَا سَافِلَهَا. We made the up of it, up, the up made it down. The upside down. turned it upside down.
There was a narration when brother was saying that somebody asked Shafi'i, what's the dalil for qiyas? Allahu a'lam this. And he spent 3 nights praying, just pondering over the Quran, just no sleep.
So he believed in qiyas, and then when he asked him why, he went to pray 3 nights to find the dalil.
Yeah.
Okay, what did he find?
How convinced is he on his dalil?
He wouldn't say to ask him, he's been 3 nights, yeah, that doesn't even make sense. Because, you hear what he just said?
What?
The brother said that if Shafi'i was asked, what's the dalil for qiyas? So he went away on 3 nights, he was praying humbly, mashallah, consistency, to find the dalil.
I mean,
so what was his dalil?
He wasn't firm, he wasn't firm upon his choice.
So he believed in something and then went to look after it for dalil.
I am happy to read
what Ibn al-Qayyim and Ibn al-Kathir has said, and some of these people, even though I'm not very, when I talk to the people now, when they give the examples, I just give up. I say, you're right, because you can't give them an answer. Sometimes, if someone you ask someone, what is the proof that prayer is an obligation? He tells you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you have to fast Ramadan. What are you going to tell him?
What is the what?
If you ask someone, what is the proof about prayer being an obligation? He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that he has sent Quran in Ramadan.
He doesn't answer the question.
No,
so what's the answer you are going to give this person? You understand? Some people talk like this.
Salaam alaikum.
That is.
Inshallah, tomorrow, maybe.
Salaam alaikum.
Yeah. Now, let's continue with Ibn al-Qayyim.
Okay, you know, let me just continue with last time you said, something that the whole week was in my head.
Yeah.
That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, surely if this was any other than Allah, there would be many contradictions. That is clear. Even I am not that intelligent, and I can understand that.
Yes.
If you get two fiqh books and you put them next to each other, that's contradictions.
Yes.
So if this is from Allah using qiyas, then how is there contradictions? Okay, when this was said to the people who use qiyas, what's there, what do they say after that?
You will find that the people who have difference between them are these people. Not there, of course, it will be the Ahnaf. They will have never difference amongst them. Because they just stick to what Abu Hanifa says. Without. And the Shafi'is, the Sawal, as Malikis. But against each other, the Malikis and the Ahnaf and the. You will find that they contradict each other in about maybe 70% of the madhab. The least people, the people who say Quran and Sunnah. Quran and Sunnah, but they don't follow a man at all. They don't follow Ibn Hazm, they don't follow Dawood, they don't follow. They are independent. You will find the least people who contradict each other are these people. Because Quran and Sunnah are clear. And you can't make a difference. Yes, sometimes you do. That is because of the human nature, weakness, understanding. However, it's not because, but they always stick to the hadith. Now, can you tell me how these the examples that Ibn al-Qayyim has brought about grass being like human, or human creating like another human, or someone who doesn't act on his knowledge being as dog, what has this to do with when Rasulullah ﷺ say dates shouldn't be sold with dates except hand for hand? How this can be used to say that banana shouldn't be sold with banana except hand by hand?
Yeah.
What these examples have to do with this? Now,
so easy for
in Quran,
what's the explanation for the last one that you said about the hadith about the man with the color?
The color. Actually, that Bukhari has given the answer. Bukhari, in his book, he said how Rasulullah ﷺ used to give examples known. Both known. Not one known and the other not known. Not one root, another branch. How he used to give examples to make it clear, to help the person understand without using any qiyas. This is how the title of Bukhari. And because if you say roots and branch, so the camel is the root and the human is the branch. And Rasulullah is doing qiyas here, human, on the camel. So when you go to Hajj and Eid day, we have to slaughter a human being. Because it's the same. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is saying here that human being is like a camel. The man answered himself. He knew. He knew it not from religion. He knew it. It's dunya thing. This man knew that the camel will be black if he inherits this gene. And we know that the same thing happens to human. He just because he couldn't understand this, he want him to understand it, he want him to give the answer to himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never said in the Quran or any hadith that a human will be black if his grandfather is black. So this has nothing to do with qiyas.
Could it be wahi?
Wahi? Even it may be that Rasul just said it like that. Just like when he said about the palm dates.
The dates, yeah. Yeah.
This is something that you know.
To avoid suspicion.
Yeah, because this man was trying to say something. Oh, my wife, I'm accusing her. I'm not sure of what she has done. Now, look the Quran about qiyas. I give you the example of the prophets. Another example here. Who knows better than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what the things that are similar? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the kafir say, إِنَّمَا الْبَيْعُ مِثْلُ الرِّبَى. That transaction selling
is similar
to riba. He never said, no, you are wrong. Yeah, selling is like riba. You sell money for money. I sell you 1,450. It's selling. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them what is not similar. The selling is like riba. Yes. وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ. But Allah made bay'a halal and riba haram. وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الْرِبَى. This is the answer. He didn't say, no, they are not similar, you are lying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَمَا لَكُمْ أَلَّا تَأْكُلُوا مِمَّا لَمْ يُذْكَرِ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. Why are you not eating from what Allah's name has been slaughtered on? وَقَدْ فَصَّلَ لَكُمْ مَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ. And he has told in details what is haram for you. وَإِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ لَيُحُونَ إِلَىٰ أَوْلِيَائِهِمْ. And the shayateen tell their awliya, لِيُجَادِلُوكُمْ. So they will
argue
with you. This is similar to this. This is should be like this. What is the difference between this and this? And this is what this ayah was. Why this ayah has been revealed? This ayah was revealed because the Persians went to the kuffar of Quraysh and told them, "You slaughter it. This is Allah slaughtered it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the same. And you say this is halal. This is haram." Doesn't make any sense. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the answer of Allah. This is not similar to this. Because Allah didn't make it. There is qiyas and qiyas. Now qiyas, according to Ibn Qayyim, he tried to divide it into different categories. Not that the other people know. But the majority of who say qiyas, say this is three type of qiyas. Qiyas al-awla, and qiyas al-shabah, and qiyas al-adna. Now qiyas al-awla is this.
Al-awla?
Al-awla.
Number one.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. It means if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made what you slaughter with your hand halal, then what he slaughtered himself should be halal. This is more likely, more worthy to be halal. You understand? This is
well, Allah who said say
the people who make qiyas.
Okay.
They say qiyas al-awla. This is qiyas al-awla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said the one who kills,
yeah,
the one who kills must pay diya. Blood money. And the one who, by mistake. But what he must do kafara. He must fast. Either free a slave or either free a slave or fast 60 days, 2 months. Now they say here, the one who did it by mistake should fast, should free a slave. The one who did it intentionally definitely must have to. Even though it's not in hadith. Not everybody agrees with this. This is the Shafi'is.
What do they say, Shaykh?
Someone who has killed by mistake, he will pay the blood money, yes?
Is that what he says in the Quran, yeah?
Yes. Okay. This is one thing.
Mistake,
but,
blood money.
Yeah. But after he pays the blood money, he must free a slave.
That's what Allah says.
Yes. This is what Allah says in the Quran.
Or fast 3 months. 2 months.
If he can't.
Then he fast. If he can't, then he fast.
No, or.
Okay. He has option. Maybe.
Yeah. So now, فَكَفَّارَتْ فَصِيَامُ شَهْرَيْنِ مُتَابِعَيْنِ تَوْبَةً شَهْرَيْنِ مُتَابِعَيْنِ تَوْبَةً مِنَ اللَّهِ ها؟ الله سبحانه وتعالى سيد فدية مسلمة إلى أهله إلا أن يصدقوا فدية مسلمة إلى أهله إلا صدقوا الله سبحانه وتعالى سيد القرآن ومن قتل مؤمن متعمدا فجز أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ومن قتل مؤمنا خطأ فدية مسلمة إلى أهله إلا أن يصدقوا فإن كان من قوم عدو لكم فتحرير رقبة مؤمنة ودية مسلمة إلى أهله فمن لم يجد فصيام شهرين متتابعين توبة من الله فمن لم يجد you have to free a slave huh? You have to free a slave which is a believer slave مؤمن huh? If you can't, you do the fasting of two months.
Okay. Is that a choice or if you can't?
No, if you can't. This is if you can't. The other one is.
You can't free a kafir. Huh? There's no point in freeing a kafir slave.
No, here is to free a Muslim. This is we go to the similar one and we will talk about it. Now the Shafi'i say no. You have to even the one who has done it by intentionally must do this. Must free a slave.
So the adding on for him.
Yeah, on the top of
the 60 days fasting.
Yeah, on the top of being killed.
He has to fast 60 days before he gets killed.
He must pay the kafara. But sometimes he is not killed. Sometimes he is forgiven.
Yeah.
So he must pay the kafara.
Mm.
You understand?
2 months.
Yes, qiyas. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said if you do it by mistake, he said even if he does it by intentionally.
So,
he said the one who does it intentionally is worse. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
So how can we say to this person fast or free a slave and we don't tell this person?
Mm.
Actually I tell you I can with opinion I can give you the best better answer than yours. Because this person made it by mistake. And he has a kafara, he can do something to repair his mistake. Mm. This would do it intentionally. No matter what he does, he can't repair it.
Mm.
So if you want, he can't repair that except by tawbah.
Mm.
And by the dead people, the dead person forgiving him. There is no kafara for that.
Mm. So if you kill someone
intentionally,
a Muslim,
yeah.
And say for example you get away with it.
Yeah.
And then you go to a far land.
Yeah.
And you make tawbah. You yes. realize your mistake. You yes. make tawbah.
Yeah. That is if you do, this is tawbah. I say tawbah. It's like shirk. Huh? If I do qiyas here, I say the person who has killed intentionally, because he is no way like someone who has killed by mistake, must actually free 100 slaves.
Yeah.
And the person who has committed shirk. Because it's with the bigger sin,
yeah.
must have to free 1,000 slaves.
Mm.
This is qiyas.
Yeah. Let's make in Sharia different law. Man.
Mm. Yeah, different law.
Week.
This is.
Last
what is the qiyas? The similar qiyas. The similar qiyas is this.
Allah so this is the al-awwal.
Yes, qiyas al-awla. Now Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the similar qiyas. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran said that.
What's it called in Arabic?
Shaba.
Resembling. Yeah, resembling. Now, the other qiyas which is similar, they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah An-Nisa, about someone who kills by mistake, he must free a believer slave. Yeah? But when he spoke about dhihar, someone who tells his wife, you are for me like the back of my mother. This person shouldn't approach his wife until he do kafara. And one of these kafara is to free a slave.
In 2 months. And the free 60 years.
He must free a slave. But in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never said that he should free a slave, a believer slave. He said general slave. Yeah? He said a slave. Yeah? So, they said, well, here we have to do qiyas.
What ayat number is that, sir?
This is Surah Al-Mujadala. Surah Al-Mujadala. Which surah it is? I give you Quran and you help me. The number of the surah. I can give you the ayah. The ayah is number 4.
Verse 58.
Yeah. So they did qiyas here on the other surah, on the other surah. But the surah of the about the killing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, freeing a believer slave. If you don't find, you fast 2 months.
So you don't alternatively get a kafir slave and free him and then you...
Yeah. But the surah of Mujadala, he says that you should free a slave. They say we do qiyas, meaning a believer slave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here said, if you don't find, then you do, if you don't find it, you fast 2 months. If you can't, you feed 60 people. They didn't say on the, if you killed, if you can't fast 60 days. They didn't do qiyas and say, if you can't find it, you have to do 60, you feed 60 people. That is the qiyas. If you do qiyas.
One more time, please, Sheikh.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, for the one who kills, he should free a slave, believer. If he can't,
then he fast.
He must fast and stops there. For the one who says to his wife, you are as for me like the back of my mother, he must free a slave, general slave.
And this is the people who use qiyas say this?
No, this is Quran, what Quran
okay,
says.
Okay, so.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say he must free a slave.
Okay.
He said, no, not a slave, a believer slave.
So Allah said in the Quran,
a slave.
To the man
who
marries...
Who tells his wife.
Oh, who tells his wife.
Yeah, you are like the back of my mother.
Okay, was this a tradition in the Arabs?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
So he told if he want her back,
no.
Before he touch her, he must free a slave.
Okay.
They said not a slave, a believer slave. So where did you get to the word believer? He said it's in the
Surah
in the Surah Nisa about the one who kills someone. Yes. So we do qiyas. Okay. Okay, let's continue with the ayah. If he can't free a slave, he must fast 2 months. Exactly like the other surah.
Yeah.
But if he can't fast 2 months, he must feed 60 people.
Okay.
Yeah? Why don't you do qiyas here and say the one who kills, if he can't fast 2 months...
So if you do it one way, you should do the other way.
Why not? So what's the difference?
And if he intentionally kills, then he should feed 60 people.
Yeah,
is this majority you say this?
No, if he intentionally, if he intentionally kills, then he must feed Ethiopia or Somalia.
Okay.
One time voyage.
What's this majority say this? About these examples?
The majority say that about the
believer.
The believer.
That's majority say that.
Yes. And this is one of the examples that Ibn Qayyim brings. Okay, this is...
Water of Katie Pitt?
This is water of Zandar.
No. Forgive me, Sheikh.
Yeah, that's fine. The other ayah...
Allah for you.
The other ayah... The other example for the other one. Yeah. The example for the other one.
Okay.
قياس الأدنى. This mean now we said the other قياس here is the أدنى. If the one who by mistake kills, no, that's not. I just give you an example. So the one who
says it,
who kills by intentionally, is more likely. It's must. Now it's the opposite. Allah Subhanahu wa Taala said in the Quran, the same example that Ibn al-Qayyim has given about if someone kills a savage animal from the that doesn't domestic, he must pay. Allah Subhanahu wa Taala said in ayah, وَمَنْ قَتَلَهُ مِنْكُمْ مُتَعَمِّدًا, the one who kills it intentionally. What is the Quran in English? The one who kills the animal, give it the Quran. The one who kills this animal intentionally, not by mistake.
ومن قتل
ومن قتله منكم متعمدا يا الله سبحانه وتعالى says in ayah number 94, O you who believe, God doth but make a trial of you in a little matter of game, well within reach of your hands and your lances. Yeah. O you who believe, kill not game while in the sacred precinct in pilgrimage garb. If any of you doth so intentionally, the compensation is an offering brought to the Kaaba of a domestic animal equivalent to the one he killed. They said even if he does it by mistake. Allah Subhanahu wa Taala said he who does it intentionally, they said even if he does it by mistake, the majority, the four madhab. This is qiyas. Doing it by mistake is less. It's not bigger than, but yeah, we do qiyas here even anyway. And then they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mean just intentionally, even by mistake. Read this ayah and see if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really want to talk about the one who made it by mistake. Let's finish the ayah. If any of you doth so intentionally, the compensation is an offering brought to the Kaaba of a domestic animal equivalent to the one he killed, as judged by two just men amongst you, or by way of atonement, the feeding of the indigent, or its equivalent in fasts, that he may test of the penalty of his deed. Though God forgives what is past, for repetition, God will exact from him the penalty, revenge. If he does it again, Allah will revenge. They say there is no difference between intentionally, so Allah will revenge sometime, someone who is walking in the street by mistake. He got an animal killed, and second time by mistake he killed. Allah will revenge him and ينتقم الله منه. Is it this ayah addresses someone who did it by mistake?
What does he mean by revenge? Does he mean that Allah is going to bring something upon him? Or?
Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for God is, no, for repetition, God will exact from him the penalty.
This in Arabic?
ينتقم الله منه. انتقام, I don't know if he got it here right. It doesn't look to me that, because انتقام is this. The انتقام according to والله. Yeah.
نقم.
انتقام is take revenge.
Okay.
This is what Allah has said about انتقام. Let me perhaps والله عزيز ذو انتقام. And Allah,
okay, he's the one who possesses revenge.
Yeah, guide to mankind, and he sent down the creation. Also, yeah. And God is exalted in might, Lord of retribution.
Retribution.
Okay. Now, this clearly show that, and that Allah Subhanahu wa Taala didn't want. If He wanted to say, the one who killed by mistake, why He would add this word? If you do it intentionally. And now we go to the examples that they give us. Okay, if you don't do qiyas, what are you going to do with this? This is what Ibn Qayyim, Ibn Kathir, Ibn Nawawi all the time do. They give you examples. The Sahaba did this, the Sahaba did this, they did qiyas. Now, they say Abu Bakr and Umar did qiyas. When there was difference between the Sahaba, who is going to be the Khalifa? Umar ibn Khattab said, Abu Bakr Rasulullah accepted him as a leader for our religion, Salat. Are we not going to accept him for our dunya? This is qiyas. So the Sahaba here is qiyas. Okay. First, prove that Abu Umar ibn Khattab has said this by Isnad Sahih. After you have proved it, this is the answer. Nobody has said that Umar ibn Khattab is someone who doesn't do mistakes. Even them, they say this, that Umar ibn Khattab may do mistakes. Ibn al-Qayyim say in his book that there is no hadith that mentions states Abu Bakr as the Khalifa.
There's no hadith?
Yeah, that Rasulullah said that Abu Bakr should be the Khalifa after him. Of course, there is hadith in Musnad Humaydi, which is considered sahih by the majority, who has spoken about the hadith, that Rasulullah said, bring me a book, I will write it, so nobody will wish or hope, and Allah and the believers will not accept except Abu Bakr. So he probably has forgotten this hadith. However, in the same book where he denies that Rasulullah never mentioned that the Khalifa should be Abu Bakr after him, in the same book, when he comes to talk about following the Sahaba, he says that the Prophet has said, and he mentioned hadith in Tirmidhi, which is da'if, but he considered to be sahih, that Rasulullah has said, follow those behind me, Abu Bakr and Umar. Those after me. Follow those after me. Right. So he say, anyway, he says that there is no mentioning of Abu Bakr and Umar or anyone. And in the same book, he says that Rasulullah has stated that two after him is Abu Bakr and Umar. Hadith is daif. However, the answer to this hadith is this. We have hadith as well in Musnad Ahmad, where Abu Bakr, when he was arguing with the Ansar, he said this. He said, Rasulullah said, Al-A'imma min Quraysh, the Imams are from Quraysh. No way that the Ansar would have accepted Abu Bakr just like that. They are the people of the land. And they will not accept Umar Qiyas and leave the right. They were fighting for this. And if we use this, Ali ibn Abi Talib, those who say Ali ibn Abi Talib is more rightly to be Khalifa, then yeah, because Rasulullah never left Abu Bakr behind him to rule Medina. He left him as Imam of prayer. And he made Salim Mawla Abu Hudayfa as Imam for prayer. And he made Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum as Imam of prayer. But he went and left Abu Ali after him, and he said, don't you want to be like me, like Harun, the way Harun was
Musa.
After Musa. Musa, when he left Harun behind him as to lead the people. And when he died, Harun took over. So if we use Qiyas here, then Ali ibn Abi Talib is more worthy.
And that hadith is here?
Yes. Now, if they say you qiyas, if they use qiyas here, then the answer is this. If you use qiyas, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has trusted Abu Bakr, Rasulullah has trusted Abu Bakr for the religion, why shouldn't we trust him for the dunya? Then the answer of this, for the Shafi'is and the Hanbalis, who say that a boy can lead the prayer. The answer is this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَابْتَلُوا الْيَتَامَى, test the orphans. حتى إذا بلغوا النكاح, when they reach the age of marriage, فإن آنستم منهم رشدا, then you test them. If you see that they are okay, they are people who of understanding, then give them their money. Then the answer for the Shafi'is and the Hanbalis. Huh? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't trust the children with their dunya, why do you let them lead the prayer and do the adhan?
Huh? And trust them with
you should do qiyas here and say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't trust them with their dunya. How can we trust them with our deen and let them lead us in a prayer?
Yes, it's permissible to lead a child.
Yes, they say that it's permissible for a child to lead the prayer and to do the adhan and to do a lot of things, but not everything.
What about standing in front line?
Of course, if he can, if he can sit behind before you,
yeah.
He can sit with you. If he can stand with you, so this is the answer for that. And then they say Ali ibn Abi Talib, Umar ibn Khattab, when people started drinking alcohol, sent to Ali ibn Abi Talib. What do you say about this? What do you say? How we should we punish them? Ali ibn Abi Talib supposedly said that when he drinks, what happens to him? He will talk, unnecessary talk. And when he talks unnecessary talk, he will start talking about people honor. This person has committed zina, this person. And we know that the person who talk about people in their honor, he should be beaten 80 lashes, according to Quran, Surah An-Nur. So Ali ibn Abi Talib came with the opinion, according to them, that the one who drink alcohol, because when he drink alcohol, he start talking nonsense and talking about people honor, we should punish him 80 lashes by qiyas. They said here the Sahaba did qiyas. First, this hadith is the best of its, the isnad of this hadith is from Sha'bi from Ali ibn Abi Talib. And Sha'bi remember one stuff from Ali ibn Abi Talib. He remember him, he said, I saw him stoning a woman from Hamadan. But the story here is between Umar and Ali. So if he remember Ali in his Khilafah, like 8 years before Ali's death. But the story here didn't happen at the time of Ali, it happened at the time of Umar al-Khattab. At that time, probably the mother of Sha'bi was not married yet. So the hal, and this is the best isnad of it. And if we take it as to be sahih, then people when they drink have different states. Some people they drink, they go to sleep. So we shouldn't do anything to them. Some people drink and start remembering Allah. So we should praise them. Some people drink and kill. So we should kill them. So this doesn't make sense. No matter who said it.
So the ruling was Ali said that because when he drinks he talks about people.
Yeah.
Allah says those who talk to our people should be left 80.
Yes. So this is qiyas.
But what about Abu Bakr? He did 40, right?
Yes.
Why, where did he get the 40 from?
No, he didn't do Rasulullah, the truth is, when someone drinks, Rasulullah will see beat him.
Oh yeah.
So people will beat him. So Abu Bakr looked at it, how long it lasted. Oh, it's almost 40. So, because there is no limit here, so you can beat, but don't kill him, it's beat him only. So beat him. This is what you should do when there is someone drinking, as long as the people who are there are human beings, not people who are bloodthirsty, because if you tell him beat him, he will take his sword and cut his neck. So as long as the human there are human being, not crazy, you just tell them beat him.
So that was just the ijtihad from Abu Bakr?
Yes.
When Prophet ﷺ followed the sunnah, the arm upon and the sahaba, is that hadith sahih?
No, the hadith is daif.
Yeah? So there's no narration if the Prophet advised us to follow the sahaba?
No, he can't tell you to follow the sahaba.
That's what I was going to say.
There is so many hadith about following the sahaba. The most of them are mawdu', made up hadith. The following of the Sahaba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised the Sahaba and said those who follow them. The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said those who believe and their children follow them doesn't mean that you are going to follow your father and mother. You follow them, you'll be on their way. The way the Sahaba, you follow the Sahaba in this. You believe in the Prophet and accept what the Prophet has said. Doesn't mean you accept their understanding. As long as their understanding is according to the Quran and Sunnah, that's fine.
What about?
How did the Prophet deal with his companion, the one that we hear about that used to be an alcoholic and he would drink and he asked, I don't know if this is true, Salafis told me, yeah, that he told Aisha and her to tie him and stuff.
He's going to a battle.
Because he's going to a battle or something, and they told him to tie him that he wouldn't, and just to release him, I think.
Yeah.
Allah him, to release him when it's time to fight, and not, so he wouldn't drink. Allah him.
I will understand. I understand. I used to think why people, sometime hadith, people who make hadith before.
Yeah.
How they twist the story and change hadith from one hadith to another hadith. But now, every time I hear someone telling me this hadith, I understand where they get it from. This hadith at the time of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Rasulullah not involved, Aisha not involved. This is Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas with someone called Abu Mihjan, who used to drink, but he was a good fighter. And then they tie him at the time of a battle, and he cheated someone, told him open, and then he went and did good in the battle, and but he would not, was not, according to the hadith, he was forgiven, and that's wrong. This hadith is a story anyway, without isnad, sahih. But if it was sahih, it means Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas will never forgive the had of Hadudullah, forgive someone just because he had did something good. If you drink alcohol, you got to be punished, no matter what you do after that.
We were talking about Ibn
al-Qayyim.
Was it Ibn
al-Qayyim
before? Oh, no, you're talking about the...
No, Ibn al-Qayyim will never say that Aisha did and the Rasulullah did. He was not very good in hadith, but not to this level.
You're talking about the three levels of... the
we finished...
Qiyas al-Awla.
Qiyas
al-Awla.
Qiyas al-Awla, Qiyas al-Shaba, and Qiyas al-Adna. Yeah, this is another example that now they give you the examples. What do you say about this? What do you say about it? Yeah. Now they tell you, okay, you people don't do qiyas.
What do you do then?
What do you do when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't eat the flesh of the pig? Do you eat the fat? Do you drink the milk of the pig?
We'll go back to the verse. What does the verse say?
The Quran say, قُلْ لَا أَجِدُ فِي مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ مُحَرَّمًا عَلَى طَاعِمٍ. I don't find what has been revealed to me that is haram except this and this, and the flesh of the pig, because it's dirty. They say, okay, the flesh of the pig, you don't eat it. What do you do with the fat? Do you eat it? They say, no, we don't eat it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, because it's dirty. Not the flesh, it has to go to the next mentioned, the pig. And by saying the pig is dirty, everything is dirty, whatever it's in there. They say, no, you are playing here games. Shafi'i ibn Kathir said, you are playing here games. It doesn't mean the pig, it has to go to the flesh. But he contradicts himself again. Here, because he has something against the people who don't do qiyas. You just go few surah, أَتَى أَمْرُ اللَّهِ فَتَسْتَعْجِلُهُ. The order of Allah has come. Don't hurry him. He say, don't hurry him. It's for Allah. So first he said, no, it has to go to the order normally, according to his rule. Order of Allah, flesh of the pig. So here he forgot what he said there, and he said it, put it the right way. Because in the Arab language, it will go, or he will go to the nearest mentioned. I say, Muhammad Sa'id Kamal came, and he was eating. Who was eating? Muhammad Sa'id or Kamal? No, Kamal, the last one, the nearest one. So it's the pig. That is haram. Ibn Hazm, Ibn Qayyim and Ibn Kathir give this answer to Ibn Hazm, because he gave this answer. So they gave him this answer, no, it doesn't mean anything. But so the truth is, nobody has written about this again. This is the answer to this. Hadith from Muslim. First, the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same surah, after he mentioned this, after he mentioned about what's haram for the Muslims, he said, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ هَادُوا, and for those who For the Jewish, حرمنا كل ذي ظفر. We made haram this and this and this. ومن حرمنا كل ذي ظفر ومن الأنعام حرمنا عليهم شحومهما إلا ما حملت ظهورهما. And from the cattle, we made haram for them.
And the fat.
The fat. Yeah. Okay. If you make qiyas on the fat because of the meat that are the same, why don't you say? Why do you say here that for the Bani Israel, the fat was haram, but the flesh was not? Why don't you think they were stupid because they didn't do qiyas? Allah made haram for them the fat. He should have made the flesh halal, haram.
So Allah Subhanahu wa Taala said in the ayah that He made the flesh halal, but the fat haram for them.
No, He made the flesh.
The fat haram.
And what halal for them?
Meaning, if you're gonna use it like they're gonna use it, yeah. He goes, if you're gonna use it like they're gonna use it, then it means that
the Allah Subhanahu wa Taala haram. Hear these verses. Hear first. I find not in the message received by me, by inspiration, any meat forbidden to be eaten by one who wishes to eat it, unless it be dead meat or blood poured forth, or the flesh of swine, for it is an abomination. Yes? Because the swine is abomination, that's why we don't eat it. And the ayah following ayah, for those who followed the Jewish law, we forbade every animal with undivided hoof, and we forbade them the fat of the ox and the sheep, except what adheres to their backs. So we forbade them the fat of the ox and the sheep. That didn't make them forbade
the flesh.
The flesh. Mm. And they agree with us that the flesh was halal for them. Mm.
Mm-hmm.
This is one. There is hadith in Muslim where Aisha said that the Prophet said, whoever has slaughtered with us in that Eid, he shouldn't eat the meat of his sheep or whatever slaughter or sacrifice more than 3 days. She said, the following year, the Sahaba started melting the fat to keep it. And Rasulullah was told, he said, why? He said, because you have forbidden the eat of the flesh more than 3 days. He said, that was because there was hunger at the time. I want people to give. So if they know that they are not going to eat more than 3 days, they must distribute it.
Mm.
This is the Sahaba that you say understand and make qiyas. When Rasulullah told them not to eat the meat, they were melting the fat to keep it.
Why did they... That's that one though.
And you say the milk is the same as the meat. This is the Hanabila who believe that eating, Rasulullah said, whoever eat the camel meat should do wudu. This is the Hanbali saying, if you drink the milk of the camel, you shouldn't do wudu.
Why?
Because Rasulullah said, if you eat the meat, you should do wudu. So if you do qiyas, or the milk of the pig, on the flesh of the pig, why don't you do qiyas here and say, if you drink the milk of the camel, you should do wudu as well.
Mm.
See the contradictions?
Clearly.
Uneducated bunch of people.
And he tells you, and this is another example. This is maybe it's the... They say Rasulullah ﷺ said, was asked about a rat that dies in oil. And Rasulullah said, if it is hard, if it's not liquid, then you have to throw it away with around what's around it. But if it's liquid, you have to throw it all together. They say, okay, this is a rat in oil. What do you say about a cat in milk? A cat fall in milk and it died in the milk. What do you do with it?
Drink it.
Well, now for the Ibn Hazm, for example, he say no. That is the rat with the oil, nothing else. The majority say any animal with anything. Oil. Anything, milk, whatever. But I will say here actually it's not. It is neither what Ibn Hazm has said, neither what they have said. Ibn Hazm has looked, didn't look at the whole hadith properly. It is the rat with anything. Because Rasulullah was asked about a rat specific. But when he gave the answer, he said, if it's hard, he didn't say, if the oil is hard. He said, if it's hard, anything that is hard, okay, you throw it, the rat, with what's around it. If it's a liquid, he said, if it's a liquid, we don't look at the question, we look at the answer. Yeah. The answer is general. If it's a liquid, he didn't say if the oil was a liquid. So any liquid where a rat falls and dies, you have to throw it away altogether. And if he tell me it doesn't make sense, no, it does make sense. A cat is a cat. Actually, we know now that the rat has a special disease that no animal has it.
So in the case of a cat being in the thing here,
yeah,
just throw it away just for...
Well, if someone doesn't want to drink it,
it's up to him.
You see, I tell you something.
Yeah.
The four madhahib agree about if there is someone who is diseased, you know this disease, the rash
leprosy,
disease?
Leprosy.
If someone has leprosy and then he spit in water, that this water is halal. It's halal to sell it to a person without even telling him.
So and it's a disease that you can catch?
Well, we don't believe in diseases being cut. Caught. So it's not a question. You don't like it. If it's offered to you with no money, if they pay you to drink it, you will not. But still halal. So if a rat if a cat died in somewhere, well, it's still, you have to throw it away. If it's something hard, you throw it just with the
surroundings.
But then what if, for example,
if a cat is that in liquid, but that liquid has not changed.
What if it has disease?
It has disease.
If the cat has disease,
yeah,
and it dies in the water.
Yeah, what you do is you drink the water, you throw the cat out, yeah, and if you want to use it, you can use it. We don't believe that you catch diseases from... Rasulullah said, La adwa. Rasulullah said, La adwa. There is no disease
contagious.
Then a man said, what about my camels? They will be in the, yeah, like gazelles in the sand, and one sick comes in between them, and they become sick. He said, okay, who gave the disease to the first one? The first one, the first animal to get sick, the first ever to get sick, who gave him the disease?
Okay, but let's say, for example, you see these people who have made AIDS, they made it, if you can correct me if I say, Allah never made it.
See, this hadith, no, there is no contagious things, we don't believe in that. However, Rasulullah said, La adwa, there is no adwa. وَفِرَّ مِنَ الْمَجْدُومِ فِرَارَكَ مِنَ الْأَسَدِ. Run from the one who has leprosy the way you run from a lion. This is hadith. You have to believe that there is no adwa, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this reason, when people sit with someone who is sick, they get sick. But we have to believe it this way. لا عدوى. You understand? Rasulullah said, another hadith, لا يورد ممرض على مصح. Someone who is sick shouldn't be taken to someone who is not sick. Yeah? Rasulullah said, if you have ta'un, ta'un is what you get, the disease that you get from the rats.
Plague.
Yeah. If you have this disease, you are in place and there is this disease, don't go out.
Yeah,
if you are out, don't go in. Yeah, but still there is no adwa.
So how do we combine between all of these?
Yeah, there is no adwa.
Okay.
This is something that you have to do. You have to take this precaution. You have to do this. You shouldn't go out or in or go to someone who is not sick. All this, and believe that Allah, the disease that you catch, is from Allah, not from the person.
Okay, what's our understanding? Why would the Prophet, why would he tell him to stay the Ganga out?
Because you're going to spread the area. Oh, yeah, you got a point.
Why would he tell him don't get out of that area? We do not go into that area.
Because why he told him that? We are people who don't ask these questions. He said that you shouldn't go out, you shouldn't go in, and he said there is no adwa. And we know people, we know, I can say this definitely, when people, someone sick, sit among people who are not sick, it's very likely that they get sick. But if it was this, when a city, people in a city, there is disease that starts, not everybody dies, many people die. And so you will find in one house, the mother who is caring for everybody will not die. So it's not, if it was like, okay, if you...
Even a priest that used to work, the monks that used to work with the leprosy, people with leprosy, there used to be monks that worked with them, but they wouldn't get it. Even the AIDS virus, there's people that are immune.
Sometimes you find a husband and a wife that are intimate with each other, the husband will have a flu, and the wife won't catch it. He would have a sick flu.
So we have to basically increase the iman.
This is what you have to believe, that there is no, that is no. So how did we get to this? From which we started with
a point about plague, and then you went before that. You were talking about.
We were talking about the Arab.
Yeah, the Arab.
But we have finished with that anyway.
What if someone says you take out the flag?
Yeah, we say now. See, how are you going to drink something where a rat
Sorry,
the hadith of the rat.
Yeah,
I didn't catch it properly.
So the person went up to the prophet. And said, "No, I want to know."
And the person went up to the prophet and he said, "If you find a dead rat in the water. He said that I found a dead rat in oil. Okay, the man said that to the Prophet.
Yes.
Okay, and the Prophet's answer was what?
Throw it.
Yeah.
And whatever is around it.
Whatever's around it.
Yeah. That is if it's hard. If it's the thing is hard. It's not liquid.
If what is hard? The substance.
The substance.
Yeah.
Oh. If this oil, like it was in fridge and it's hard.
Okay, but it's an ice cube.
Yeah. No,
or some, you know, like butter.
You know the butter. Sometimes it's hard, sometimes it's liquid.
And the Prophet said, if it's liquid. He didn't say oil.
Yeah, he said if it's liquid. The Prophet said if it was liquid, if it is liquid, so that goes for every liquid. We don't look at the man the way he put the question. We always look at the answer of the Prophet. Because the person may ask specific question, and the Rasulullah always, sometimes, most of the times will answer general, give a general answer. They say as well, another example, they say, Rasulullah ﷺ said that that no one should urinate in
a container,
in water, still water.
Yeah.
And then take a bath in it. And they say that now this is I gave you the example where they say, oh, what the diaries will say about this. Mm-hmm. What the people who don't guess, they say, okay, what are you going to do about this? Actually, Ibn Hazm say that if someone urinate in the water, someone else, then you can take a bath in it. And actually, Ibn Hazm went further to say that if someone urinate not in the water directly, but in a jug, for example, and put it in the water, you can take a bath in it.
Why did he say that?
Well, because you see, if you don't follow your rules to the end, they will find anything, no matter how many mistakes they do. But if you just one time stop and say no here, they will make, oh, this is the biggest, you see, they don't have the idea about qiyas at all. This will be their qiyas. There will be that dalil. That you can't do qiyas is that Ibn Hazm couldn't. Said, okay, now the answer about, I give you just the general answer according to their rules. This is not something that we can discuss now, just according to their general rules. Now they say the water, the still water. Let's say just the way he dealt about this hadith. Now, the Shafi'is, say as long as the water is more than 250 liters, they bring it from one hadith which is very daif. They say as long as the water is 250 or more, and someone urinates in it, it's fine. He can't take a bath in it. So they can't say anything about Ibn Hazm really here. Understand? They say as long as the water is more than 250 rital, let's say 250 liters, it's fine that you take a bath in it. It's not haram. It's just makruh. As for Malik and Shafi'i, they say as long as this still water, when you move your hand here, the water will not move on the other side. You can't take a bath in it.
You mean Malik and Hanafi?
Yeah, Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa, he say, if you move your hand here, the water doesn't move in the other side, like in the bath. That you still can do what? Shower. And he doesn't say how much is water. Because you saw some water, the water is like this. Sometimes, the water is like this thick. This like here. If you move here, it won't move there. But if you try to put it in a jug, you can't feel it.
You know, when Brother asked Tom to find out, you know, if something you're in a swimming pool and you piss in it, can you make wudu in that water?
if the person did it himself,
or if you don't know someone done it, piss.
Yeah, the water is clean as long as it's clean. It does clean, look clean. Now the answer for that is the hadith of Buda'a, which they consider to be sahih, that Rasulullah ﷺ said that he was told that this well, which is still water, people throw in it the blood of women,
ministry,
the dead dogs, and every dirt inside. Can we drink from it? He said, water is clean. Nothing will make it filthy. So this is exactly what Ibn Hazm has said. Assalamu alaikum. Warak. About the majority, I consider it to be right, yes. But this is the answer. If you believe in it, this is, you have to take it. And this is what Ibn Hazm said. As for what is the difference between the person who has urinated in it and the person who didn't, what is the difference? This is what they say, Qiyas. The person who has urinated in, and what's the difference between the person who didn't? I believe it's haram for the same person to urinate in the water and take shower. It's haram because Rasulullah SAW said don't. And actually it's haram to urinate in water, still water anyway.
You said it's haram to urinate in a shower?
In water.
Okay, still water. Okay, if I'm having a shower and I...
Now Rasulullah SAW said, actually, even if you are not going to take shower, still water is haram to urinate in it. Because the hadith doesn't say this and then this only. There is another hadith that says don't do it and don't do this. So it's not, if I don't want to take shower, it's fine. No, that still water, you shouldn't. You shouldn't make it dirty, because you shouldn't do something like this. If you tell me what's the, now, but Ibn Hazm say there is difference between the one who does it and the one who doesn't do it. Yeah, of course there is difference. The difference between this and this is like the difference between the one who has killed and the one who has not killed. The one who has killed, we kill him. And the one who didn't, we don't. Like someone who has done haram. Is it like someone who didn't do it? And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this person has done haram, want to punish him by depriving him from using this water, we can't say no.
So if you told a guy, look, I pissed him, feel free to make wudu, I done
urinated. The water we know, according to the Hanbalis and the Shafi'is, with the condition that is more than 250 liters, and the Zahiris, then the water, no matter what you throw in it, as long as it looks water, you can drink it and cook it and understand. Of course, people will not do it. Huh?
Mm.
But is it haram? No. People will not do a lot of things. Huh? If you someone spit in the drink, yeah? If someone spit in the drink,
yeah.
Do you think that is dirty?
No.
It's halal.
Yeah.
Will you drink it?
No.
You will not. But we see that the Sahaba used to take the spit of Prophet ﷺ and rub it over their faces, and even
the thing that if the water changes color, for example.
If it changes, it's not water anymore.
Yeah. That's okay.
Yeah, we are talking about water. Yeah. We are not talking about urine itself. As for Ibn Hazm, when he said, you put it in the water.
Dawood al-Zahri said the same thing as well.
Yes,
right?
Yeah, this is actually what they take against him. Okay. Because they make halal, qiyas halal, just by Ibn Hazm making this statement. That you can, if someone does it, throw it on. That is still haram. Except for. What's the difference between someone who has didn't urinate directly in the water, but he urinated in something and throw it in the water? Now the person who does this has done haram, because you shouldn't water Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala generally wa la tufsidu fil ardi ba'da islahiha. You shouldn't
corrupt
the land.
Yeah.
Throwing. Haram thing, dirty things in water, you are corrupting this water. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Now, but what is the difference between this and this? There is a difference according to Abu Hanifa and according to Malik. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, forbidden for you are your mothers, sisters, and then amongst them, he mentioned, and your mothers that breastfeed you.
Abu Hanifa said this.
No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran that your mothers that has breastfed you are haram for you.
So those women who breastfeed you are.
Yeah. So if you breastfeed from a woman, she is your mother.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah. Now.
Sorry, before you carry on. So you see, for example, if my auntie breastfeeds my brother.
Yeah.
Then does that mean that her child
is his brother? Yeah.
Is her, what about mine? No?
No, he is his brother.
Only his?
Yes.
I was going to ask that.
Yeah. Now, this is the answer for this. Abu Hanifa say, if a woman milk is put with bread and the baby eat it, she is not his mother.
She's not?
His mother, which is true.
Point.
If the woman milk is cooked with soup and he eat it, she is not his mother. Malik say if you put milk in water and give it to the boy, the woman is not his mother. So what is the difference? He drank milk and he drank milk. Allah said, breastfeed you.
Something.
And this is not breastfeeding. And he said, urinating. He didn't say urinate something and throw it in it.
So they trapped themselves.
So, if you say this is, Ibn Hazm is stupid here. Huh?
He made a mistake.
He is making a difference between this and this. You are stupid. Huh? Because I'm making the difference between this and this.
What about, do they say if you put the milk in a cup and you give it to the boy?
It's only when he breastfeed.
Now what would they say about that one?
Some say if you drink 5 cups.
So for example,
no, if he drinks from a cup full drink, they will say it's fine. She is his mother. However, Layth ibn Sa'd say no. Layth ibn Sa'd say breastfeeding is breastfeeding when he take it directly from. But if he doesn't do it that way. Later,
Allah did not say drink the milk, he said breastfeed, yes?
Yes.
He used the word breastfeed.
Arda'anakum.
And Allah does not use words for.
So if a grown man wanted a woman to be his mom,
We don't believe that. That Ibn Hazm believes in that. The majority don't accept that, and this is the right thing.
Because haram doesn't touch her anyway.
The majority of the Sahaba and Ibn Hazm believe is breastfeeding a grown man will make him haram. and this is the wife of the Prophet, huh? Aisha believes in this, and Hafsa. Yes. Aisha, Aisha, if she wants someone to come to see her, to talk, to come and so she teach him, she will ask her sister to breastfeed him, a man, grown man. And he will breastfeed to go to her sister, and then he can sit with Aisha. There was a man called Salim, Mawla Abu Hudayfa.
Okay.
This Sahabi, man, or? Sahabi.
Okay.
He was the adoptive son of Abu Hudayfa. He adopted him in Jahiliyyah.
Okay.
He lived with him and he became a grown man.
Okay.
Then Islam said there is no such thing as adopted children. Huh? He is not your child. He is not your son.
Okay.
So when Islam decided that there is no son, this boy, this man, used to go inside the house of his master, who was considered as being his father before. Mm-hmm. Now he is not his father. The man didn't like it to see a man with his wife. Before he was a son, now he is not. Islam says he is not the son, so he didn't like it. The woman went to the Prophet complaining that we are used to him, he is like my son. And now that Islam says he is not my son, Abu, my husband doesn't like it when he comes in. He said, breastfeed him, he will become haram to you. So she breastfed him, and he became like her son. She said, actually, she told Rasulullah, how am I going to breastfeed him? He is a man. Yes. Rasulullah smiled and said, I know that he is a man. So now, this woman of the Prophet said, no, this is exception for him.
Mm-hmm.
Except Aisha and Hafsa said, no, this is general for everybody. And this is what Ibn Hazm say. And he's take it that everybody who breastfeed a man, he is her son.
So what does Aisha need to do? Let's go finish this.
Aisha will tell her sister to breastfeed someone.
Say, for example, you at that time want to learn under Aisha. Aisha says, go to my sister,
breastfeed from her.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then come.
But is it not?
And they can
see. Breastfeed from her.
Ain't it contradicting? Allah's forbidden a man yet to go near a woman who is not
Allah who I don't accept that now. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has forbidden, that is just using something against the dalil. Allah who has forbidden a man to look at a woman, of course when she take off her clothes to breastfeed him, before he is her son, he is going to look at her.
And he's going to be aroused.
But we have to remember here that the Rasulullah who told us that Allah has forbidden that action has allowed this action. So you have to accept it. However, because of another hadith which I believe came later, Rasulullah said الرضاعة من المجاعة, breastfeeding is from hunger. You understand? Rasulullah came to Aisha and saw someone sitting there, and he looked at him and said, who is this? She said, my brother, meaning breastfeeding brother. He said, look at your brothers, because breastfeeding is from hunger. So a man is not, when he's hungry, he's not going to get breastfed from a woman. He will never get filled, get full from this. This is when he is a boy. When he is still, this is his food. He doesn't need anything else. But when he is grown up, finished. He doesn't need that. And we have the ayah that said, وَالْوَالِدَةِ يُرْضَعْنَ أَوْلَادَ, the mothers breastfeed their children 2 years. So after that is gone now. That had that what he Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what
an orphan can only be before can only be your son before the 2 years. Within that 2 years.
Yes, within 2 years you can breastfeed
and that will
become your child. But
after that,
finished.
What was that hadith? Salim,
everywhere, Bukhari and Muslim and Abu Dawud and
the next one you said was from
Bukhari as well. You were born in Mecca. But he has never had a daughter. When he was dying, he came to see Aisha. he gave Aisha some land in his life. He told her, I want you to give back that land. He gave it to her, but he thought about it. He favored her from her other sisters and brothers. She had two brothers and one sister. And he told her, I want you to give the land back. Because it was wrong to give it to her anyway. If he gives someone, he must give everybody. So he told her, anyway, it's you and your sisters. When he was dying, she said, my sisters, because she has one sister. He said, the daughter of Kharija, his new wife, is pregnant. And I think she will be a girl. And he died, and she gave birth to a girl.
Kulthum was her?
Yeah, that's Kulthum.
So say for example, just one question before we go here. Yeah? If for example, you have a second sister or brother, when your father dies and he leaves his inheritance,
No, they divide. They don't.
Okay,
they don't take inheritance. Cool. They are just
just blood.
No, just the blood brothers.
I'm gonna have a